Truly, there are things I know that every time I try to express them, I just want to weep. I just want to shut up. I hate words. They're useless. And so he's saying here, listen, I don't care what kind of mind. I don't care, you know, IQ to the IQ. You are not even going to be able to begin to understand what's coming. And young people, it is not a 24/7 church service. It's a garden filled with the glory of God, the light of Christ radiating, perfect people able to perfectly render worship to God. Unflawed knowledge of him, not perfect knowledge, because he's too big to be grasped by us. But all the knowledge we have will be perfect. The relationships. I have stayed up almost every night to like 1:30. Why? Because I'm so faithful. No, because I was having such a good time talking to people I don't even know. I don't want to go to bed. It's like, well, there's a brother I never met. Well, there's a sister over there where there's family. Family. You're going to leave here today, and you're going to be there's going to be a tinge of real sadness. There will be for me. Because it's like, because we're not just people who know each other. We are one. And to think I'm going to be running around glory talking to everybody, you ought to know by now that is what I will be doing. Oh, Lord, here comes Brother Paul again. Maybe I won't be so talkative. All right, so I want you to look at something. You can't have faith. You can't have faith without knowledge. Without biblical knowledge. So you can't believe how wonderful your God is if you don't know what he has said about himself. You can't believe the wonderful future that has been decreed for you unless you know about it from Scripture. You can't believe the gospel unless the gospel is made known to you through the Scripture. You can't believe about your future if you don't know what the Scriptures say about it. So everything begins with a right understanding of this, the knowledge of God. Now, preachers, for those of you who are preachers, one of my favorite, and I don't have time to go there, one of my favorite chapters in the Bible is Job 28. I call it the minister's study. And what he's describing is a miner who is willing to go down into the very depths of the earth to cut himself off from people, to swing precariously over deep channels in the middle of the earth and chip at rock all day long. Even he knows the jewels that are there is so great, Job says, they'll literally turn over a mountain. That is the preacher's study. And one of the reasons for the weakness of the church is the weakness of the preaching, not in eloquence, not in emotion, but the weakness of the preaching in this sense. The preacher no longer sees himself as the miner who goes in there to harvest jewels, to bring them out and show them to the bride of Christ. He no longer sees himself as one who prepares food, as the good steward in order to feed the bride of Christ. Our job is like that servant who went to get a bride. Our job, Abraham's servant. I'm sure when he was bringing back that bride to Abraham's son, that maybe she was like, well, I wonder if he has teeth. I wonder if he's good looking or not. I wonder this or that. And maybe every time he saw a doubt in her face, he looked back and he pulled out his bag, another gold bracelet. Here, this is from your beloved. get ready. This bracelet's nothing compared to the man that's walking toward you in that field right there. Bride, don't be afraid. The one given this gift, my master, is far greater than the gifts he's given you. Just don't be afraid. Don't turn your camel around. Keep going. Do you see? Do you see? Now, I want to talk about faith. Faith according to, you know, I've always heard the Kantian faith is a leap into the dark. And then faith is a leap into the light. Some contradict Kant. No, it's a leap into the light. And all that's good, but what does it mean? Well, let's look at it. Hebrews 11:1. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Now, if I pull that out of context, I can turn that into an absurdity. Let me show you. Assurance, faith is the assurance of things hoped for. All my life, I have hoped to fly unaided by a machine. I mean, who wouldn't want to be Superman, right? I mean, it's like the ultimate and cool, isn't it? You can fly around. So I've always hoped to fly. And you know what? I have to tell you, this morning, I woke up with the assurance that I could. And so I'm going to dismiss myself right now. I'm going to climb up to the top of this building. I'm going to throw myself off. You say, that's absurd. No, that's exactly what this text is saying. I hope I can fly. I really do. And this morning, I'm assured of it. What's going to happen when I jump off the building? Yeah, that ain't going to be pretty. All right, the conviction of things not seen. I've never seen a human fly. But I have the conviction this morning that they can do it. So I'm going to go up and I'm going to throw myself off, do a Peter Pan right off the pinnacle of this building. What's going to happen? But I'm doing exactly what this verse says, but out of context. You see, there's two ways to sin. There's the sin of unbelief. And that's where most of us are, where we don't believe the promises that are there. The other is the sin of presumption, when we believe promises that aren't there. Let me give you an example. Pastor, there's a lady in the church. She's been abandoned by her husband, terribly abandoned. She's having to struggle with children. She feels so just lost and forgotten and no longer beautiful, and he's treated her in such a way and left her, and she's worried about her children and she's broken. And every day it's a struggle when she comes to church. It's a struggle. And the pastor talks to her and talks to her, but it just seems she's going further and further down into depression. And then one day she shows up to the church and she's full of joy. The pastor says, "What happened?" She said, "Last night, a friend of mine came over the house and said that she had a dream that she saw my husband in my kitchen and he was full of joy, and the Lord's going to bring my husband back, and that's why you see this change in me." Is that faith? No. No, it's not. But let's change the scenario. She comes in one Sunday and she has joy, real joy and real peace. And the pastor says, "What's going on?" And she said, "Well, you know, Pastor, last night I was reading through the Bible and I saw that text you've shown me so many times, but this time I saw it, that God was the husband to the widow and the father to the orphan. I don't know what's going to happen to me. There may be a long road of suffering ahead. I may be alone for the rest of my life, and I don't want to be. But Pastor, God, in His Word, tells me He will be with me as a husband. He will care for my children." That's faith. Do you see the difference? That's faith. Now, I do believe what happened. That pastor shared with her that verse many times, and she never saw it. And I do believe there was an illuminating work of the Spirit. There was the Spirit's help and the Spirit's application. I do believe that because she had read it many, many times for months. But nevertheless, it's the Word of God. It's the promises of God. Abraham. Now look at this. Without becoming weak in faith, he contemplated his own body, now good as dead, since he was about 100 years old, and the deadness of Sarah's womb. Yet with respect to the promise of God, he did not waver in unbelief, but grew strong in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully assured that what God had promised, he was able also to perform. Now, as Hebrews 11:1 is the greatest definition of faith, here we have the greatest concise illustration of faith in a package. Now, why do I say greatest concise? Because this is not the greatest illustration of faith. The greatest illustration of faith is Jesus Christ going through Gethsemane on the cross. I can assure you, the greatest man of faith who ever walked this planet is Messiah. But it is the most concise for us. He had reasons to become naturally weak. Why? His body is as good as dead. He's about 100 years old. And his wife, the deadness of her womb, she's an old woman. So he looks around him and there's no reason to believe. There is absolutely nothing to sustain his faith. Nothing. No physical thing to look at and say, this could happen. So if he believes it, he believes it only because of the character of God. There's no other reason to believe it. There's nothing to support his faith. Everything is the contrary. Yet with respect to the promise of God, he did not waver in unbelief, but grew strong in faith, giving glory to God. This is absolutely impossible apart from two things: his knowledge of the character of God and his knowledge of a real promise that came from the mouth of God. And being fully assured that what God had promised, he was able also to perform. Now look at this. He could not have been fully assured of what God had promised if he didn't know what God had promised. You know, Spurgeon wrote, I've seen titles in his sermons and small books that today, when I read those titles, I cringe. Like, God's checkbook. I kind of cringe. Why? It was entirely appropriate for him to write that, but because we're surrounded by so many heretical prosperity preachers and self-help preachers and stuff that use titles like that, that we've gotten where we can't use language that does pertain to us as children of Zion. So you hear God's checkbook or something, and you're like, ugh, that sounds like it came from a TV evangelist. But what Spurgeon is saying there is that there are promises, not merely promises with regard to salvation or with sanctification, but promises regarding everything that you could come into conflict with. And that believers are like living in poverty. Why? Because they don't have faith. But it's not because they got to screw themselves up and get more faith. The problem is, of course they don't have faith because they don't even know what God's promised them in that given scenario. And so we need to know. I mean, wouldn't you want to know everything? You see, when you have promises, when God's promised something, is he going to do it? Yes. But you have not because you ask not. And you ask not because, well, I'm going to turn it around a little because you don't even know what to ask. Or you'll ask something and you don't even know if he'll do it because it's not founded on something he revealed in his scriptures. Do you see how important the Scriptures are. Now, I used an illustration last night that I actually heard, I think it was from the late Jay Adams. Or it was one of those guys, but it's really a good illustration. So let's say I'm counseling a man on the third floor of a building and there's a big picture window. And I'm counseling him. All of a sudden, he looks at the open door into my office. He starts screaming, jumps up, jumps right out the window through the plate glass, falls three stories, and breaks both legs. So I've always asked guys I was teaching, younger ministers, okay, what's your conclusion here? Well, he's crazy. Okay, let's change the scenario. He's in the hospital now, and I ask him, why did you jump up out of the chair screaming and throw yourself through a plate glass window and fall three stories? Well, he says, because there was an 8-foot tarantula coming through the door with fangs that were about 1 foot long with poison dripping out of them. I asked the students, so what is your diagnosis? He's crazy. No, he's not. Actually, what he did was very rational. If I saw an 8-foot tarantula coming through the door with fangs this big, with poison dripping out of them, what would I do? I would throw myself out a window. I've been in places where tarantulas are only this big and you want to throw yourself out the window. A native one time, you know, I come flying out of a toilet as fast as a rocket one time. And he said, what happened? There's a spider in there as big as a horse. It jujitsu'd me. And he goes, and I come flying out there, I stumble and everything, you know. And he goes, Brother Paul, those spiders can't hurt you. I said, no, but they can sure make you hurt yourself. I mean, if I saw a tarantula coming through the door 8 feet tall, I'm going through the window. And probably so are you. And this is very rational. You stand a chance at least of just breaking a few bones, but that tarantula, it's over. So that was rational. The problem is his view of reality. That's where he's wrong. There was no tarantula there. And I say, what does this have to do with faith and what you're talking about? Absolutely everything. You have a wrong view of reality. Brother Mike was talking last night, you know, you don't understand that it really is all of grace. You don't understand that he's accomplished everything. Not only did he die under the penalties to put an end to them, he lived the perfect life in order to clothe you in his righteousness. He accomplished everything. It's grace. But if you don't believe that, if you think it's 99% Jesus and 1% you, congratulations, you're going out the window. You're just like the person who sees a tarantula, 8-foot tall tarantula. Your perception, you have a worldview that is not true. You're not living according to reality. The reality is the moment you trusted in Christ, you were legally declared righteous before God. And here's the word everyone leaves out, and they shouldn't. Because you're declared righteous, you're now treated by God as righteous. Jesus was legally declared unrighteous on that tree and treated as unrighteous. The wrath of God was poured out upon him so that you can now be legally declared righteous and treated as righteous. I see no flaw in thee, my bride. If he saw one sin in you, you go back to start or whatever, go, and you know, you got to start all over again. One sin, but you don't have one. He paid for them all. You will not be more legally righteous in heaven than you are right now. Do you see? But if you don't have that view of reality, you start doing crazy things. Do you see that? It is such a good illustration. I sometimes marvel at it. If your view of your relationship with God is not biblical, it is going to literally destroy you. And that's why faith must be based upon the revelation of God's word with regard to God's character, God's promises, God's decrees, God's works. And preacher, listen. There is a reason why God gave evangelists, pastors, and teachers to the church. Because wherever the church is weak, either these three men are absent or they're weak. It's our job to see that they know who God is. But how can you give them God, preacher, if you're just a busy boy and you never sit alone? Hours, study, prayer, reading. Just and it's the goal is not so that you can be smart. Our only goal is to feed the bride. I tell men, they go, well, you know, I don't study. I said, so you don't study for yourself? No. Well, can you study for your wife? Can you study for your children? If you don't do it for you, can you do it for your wife? She needs you to. Can you do it for your children? They need you to. But more importantly, can you do it for God? He doesn't need you to, but he's deserving of it. So faith. Now, if you know all these magnificent things about God and who he is and what he's done for you, and his disposition toward you, and what he's planned for you, and everything. If you actually believe it, I'm sorry, folks, you can't help but have joy. You can't help but have joy. So if you don't have joy, you're either looking in the wrong place, or you don't understand what you're looking at. If you don't have joy, it's because you're looking at yourself, or you're looking at God, but you don't know him very well. Faith produces joy, assurance, confidence, hope, leading to gladness of heart. Gladness of heart. When all that God is, when all that God has done, and when all that God will do for you is apprehended, it will produce a joy independent of everything but God. Did you get that last part? A joy that is not dependent upon anything except the revelation God has given you in his word about himself, his decrees, his disposition toward you, his plans for you. And those are immutable and can't change. If your joy is based on anything else, it's mutable, it's changing, it's imperfect, it never measures up. Now, Nehemiah 8:10, do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Joy that comes from union with God and faith in his person, works, and promises. Now I want to say this over and over, and I want to read it. If our joy is the result of faith and precedes obedience, that comes before obedience, then our joy will not be based on our performance, but God's performance. My joy must be based on God's performance, not mine. Unless you are really self-righteous. Because the only way you could have joy in your performance would be you're misjudging your performance. Or you're misjudging the standard by which your performance is going to be judged. Do you see that? It is so very important. If our joy is the result of faith and precedes obedience, then our joy will not be based on our performance, but upon God's. Let me give you another thing. You know, Paul is, he says that the love of God, the love of Christ constrains constrains me. And people say, yeah, Paul loved Christ so much that that motivated him. No, that's not what Paul's saying at all. Listen, Paul was of like, he comes from the same stock we come from, Adam. Paul had the same battles with flesh we have. Paul's love for Christ was nothing to boast about. You say, how dare you say that? Because it's true. An angel's love for Christ is not equal to what Christ deserves. Christ is beyond anything. Especially a man, though redeemed, yet still struggling. Do you see that? So it wasn't Paul's great love for Christ, which was changing and mutable, that constantly drove him. That's not what it says. It was Christ's love for Paul. Unchanging, perfect love, unfathomable love was what motivated Paul. Do you see that? When I talk to people about how do I love God more? Everyone has a real sense that they ought to love God more. We all do. We should. And they all think that they're going to go to some conference and get all wound up like a toy soldier. And maybe they are, man. During that conference, they are like on fire. But what always happens? Those toy soldiers wind down, don't they? 3 days later, you're back where you started from. Now, that isn't to say that we shouldn't look for special works of God and ask for God for special visitations. No, that doesn't. It's not what I'm saying. But what I'm saying is this. If you see a man who really loves his wife, I mean, serves her, loves her, treats her like a queen. I mean, a queen. And all the ladies said, amen. Treats her like a queen. What, you humanists, what do you automatically say? Man, what a wonderful man. Don't you? When you see a man love a woman, man, what a man. What a wonderful man. I want to be like that man. He's wonderful. You are so messed up in your head. You're always thinking wrong. I just say things like that because then you listen. People are looking down like this and they're like half asleep. Like, what do you mean I'm twisted? What's wrong? I'm not really mean. I just know how to keep you awake. But we always think, what a wonderful man. Maybe he's not a wonderful man at all. Maybe he has a wonderful wife. Maybe his wife is so virtuous, so beautiful in her inward spirit, such a magnificent person, that it takes this basically, you know, big galoose, takes this big, dull, half-brainless man who really isn't that passionate at all. And her beauty, inward beauty, her virtue, takes this man and draws out his affections. She's the cause of his great love for her. Because that's the same way it is with God. People say, Brother Paul, how can I love God more? And I always give them this illustration. Okay, so imagine I'm laying on the floor on my back here in the pulpit. Okay? Just right here, I'm just laying. And you walk in, and I've got both hands on my belt like this, and I'm going, I'm laying on my back, and I'm going, You walk over and you go, Brother Paul, what are you doing? I've always heard you were kind of outside the box, but what are you doing? And I'm going, well, I'm trying to get up. Brother Paul, did you ever study physics? Even physics 101. If you're going to get up that way, you have to be acted upon by an external force. Something outside of you must pull you up. You cannot pull yourself up by your own bootstraps or your own belt. Something outside of you must get you up, must pull on you. Have you ever studied the tide and the moon? It is amazing. If the moon goes away, we're all in a whole lot of trouble. Does every night the waters, just by its own force, reach us up to the moon? Is that what they do? No. The moon pulls the water. Now, how do we grow in our love for God? That's not where you should be looking. You grow in your knowledge, both biblical, factual, and experimental knowledge of God's attributes. But let me say it in a different way, of God's beauty, of God's virtue. You see, the more, if your heart is unregenerate, the more you know about God, the more you will hate him. That's just a fact, okay? Now let me give you another fact. Not 90%, no, fact, 100%, always. If your heart is genuinely regenerate, the more you know about God's virtue, his beauty, his splendor, his glory, his disposition, the manifestation of his love in the gospel, the more you know that, the more your heart, like the ocean, is going to be pulled toward him. So if you're trying to screw yourself up and wind yourself up or fire yourself up, that's just no. No, it doesn't work. You know it doesn't work. So what is going to cure this? It is not you going and reading Burkhoff. Now, I love Burkhoff, don't get me wrong. But we're not just talking about learning how to properly define things and memorizing attributes. We're talking about studying the scriptures and reading books about the attributes of God, but it's more than, you see, knowing God is not less than factual knowledge from the Bible about who he is. It's not less than that, but it is more than that. It's crying out, God, show me. Like that lady who had read the passage the pastor gave her countless times and it meant nothing, and then one day it just woke up to her and she saw it. Now here's another thing, and you listen to me very carefully. I go to prayer meetings and I'll hear people lament the fact that they don't have anguish or, how else do I put it? I have heard this, that the church began agonizing in the upper room. I don't see them agonizing in the upper room. Why would they agonize? There's nothing to be in agony about. Their master gave them promises. They just needed to calmly and joyfully believe. Be very, very careful. I was praying with a brother from Lebanon and then this really fired up evangelist guy one time who was something. And we're in this hotel room late at night. And the brother from Lebanon prayed, a man who had suffered for Christ and everything, and, you know, just prayed. And we, immediately prior to that prayer time, we were having a lovely conversation, very joyful, very light. The brother from Lebanon said, let's pray. And he prayed. It was beautiful prayer, lengthy. And then I thought, well, the evangelist. And all of a sudden, oh, God! And started, he went on the floor. I thought, should I grab his tongue? What in the world is going on? Is he having a fit? And I mean, he went wild, weeping and doing this. And I thought, goodness gracious, how do you follow that? I'm like, what happened to him? And I didn't know what to do. I was a lot younger. And when he finished praying, that old man from Lebanon poked him right in the chest like that and said, don't you ever do that again. And I was like, yeah, don't you ever do that again. Yeah, what he said, I'm not going to do it. My friend, listen to me. When I sing a hymn about the resurrection, up from the grave he arose, you see, man, yes. Woo. When its sacred head now wounded, with grief and shame weighed down, no. That's my Savior. There's no time for clapping. Same way in prayer. There's a time for agony. But I see so many people, the moment they go into prayer mode, it's agony mode. God, think about this. You know, think about this, especially you young people. What if every time my daughter, you know, my little five-year-old, every time she was hungry, she came up and she did this. Oh, Dad, I'm so hungry, and I know that I'm not worthy to eat at the table, but what? But that's what you do. I've seen you do it here this weekend. I just wanted to bring the point home. Really? What about, Lord, I'm hungry again. You've been faithful in the proper time to feed me, but I'm just going to lift this up to you. I'm hungry again. My favorite prayer, I'm going to let you into my little secret world. I'm a very fearful man. And things scare me, all the things that heart cry and all the things that we have to do. And you know what my most powerful weapon is? I get out of bed in the middle of the night. And there was this window right in our cabin. We had an old cabin. And I get down on my knees. I look out that window. And I would just say, You know, oh Lord, and then go back to bed. He knows. And yes, there is a time for anguish. And there is a time, but we're talking about a Father who has given you all things. I find the older I get, the more I go before Him just with, I'm so happy. Get that door open. I'm coming through. Heaven will never be the same, Father. Just so much. He's so good. And here's the thing. When you pray, tell Him what you need, but then don't tell Him how to answer it. He doesn't need your directions. He also doesn't need you to go into a thorough theological explanation of why your prayer is correct. He doesn't even need to know all the details because He knows them better than you do, and He knew them better than you do like a gazillion years ago. If I say off in eternity, all the little kids don't understand it, but they understand gazillion years ago. Do you see? So when you know this God and you believe His promises, there's peace. There's love. Not always, because you know what God will do? If you say, man, that guy rambles a lot, just remember, my doctors told my wife that she'd be lucky if I was in an institution after the heart attack, so I'm doing pretty well. I want you to look at something. Isaiah 50. Verse Verse 10, this is in the servant song. Who is among you that fears the Lord, that obeys the voice of his servant? Man, you are in a right relationship with God if this is you. You fear the Lord that obeys the voice of his servant. That's the Son. You've obeyed the voice of his Son when he said, rise and live. That walks in darkness and has no light. Hold it. Michael was teaching that the true Christian walks in the light. That's exactly what John says. That's exactly what John says. Walks in the revelation of God. Walks in the light of God. Yes, the purity of God. All that. So what is he saying? It's talking about believers when God, in his grace, remember how Abraham had nothing to look at to hold up his faith except the promise and God's character? Here's what God's going to do, you believer. You're going to be crying out, I want to feel something. I want to feel something. I want to see something. And there are times when things like that, a sense of the presence of God, are entirely appropriate, wonderful, and needful. But when you really start getting into the more difficult classes in God's teaching, he will leave you at times in utter darkness. Leave you without anything to sustain your hope or your faith except your knowledge of his character. And if God promised to hold the hand of Messiah when he walked on the earth, you can be sure that he holds the hands of the Messiah's disciples. So let him trust in the name of the Lord and rely on his God. Let him do that. Not trust in what he can see. God will take away your feeling. He will even take away the sense of his love from you. He will sometimes leave you and it seems completely barren. Why is he doing it? That you learn to trust in the nature, the character, the word of your God. And then he goes on, behold, all of you who kindle a fire, who encircle yourself with firebrands, walk in the light of your fire. And among the brands you have set ablaze, this you will have from my hand. You will lie down in torment. These are people who say, no, your character is not enough. Your word is not enough. I need to see something. I need to feel something. And so they go out there and they acquire strange fire. They've got to have some experience. They've got to have something, because just trusting in the nature of God. And so many believers will come to me and they'll go, I'm believing, but it's almost as though I see nothing. I feel nothing. There is nothing to support me at all. And I'm going, oh, child. And yet, you find yourself believing. And yet, you find yourself going forward. Or I'll tell them something like this. Good enough. Seems quite hopeless in your case. Did you drink and party before you became a Christian? Oh, yes, I did. Well, go back to it. If I was you, let's eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. I can't do that. No, really, really, go. Open door. I'll look up some in the Yellow Pages or get on the internet for you. Go out and have a bang-up time. I can't do that. Why? Why? Because of my God. Sounds to me like God is making you a spectacle at this moment. And he's very happy because he has left you with nothing. He's drawn from you everything. And yet at the same time in heaven, he's boasting of you. Look at my servant who walks in darkness and has no light, but trusts in my name. Do you see? Now, so many of you can identify with that, and you're going, what I thought was a desert because of my sin is actually God getting greater glory from me than he would have if I had all kinds of things around me supporting up my faith. Do you see? So now I want to go quickly. I want to talk about how joy energizes. Now, again, most people are like this. If I obey God, I will have joy. But my obedience is always so weak. I have so little joy. If all I had to do was look in the mirror, I would have very little joy. But if it's the God of all creation has shown his love toward me by sending his own son to die, and then he says, if he will do that, will he not also give me all things? And there's all, and I'm perfectly righteous before him, and I am secure, and I am, do you see now? Where's that joy coming from? I haven't even got to obedience. I'm not even thinking about me. You maybe think about you too much. Brother Paul, when I look in the mirror, I just see, well, why on earth would you look in the mirror? The Puritans would say, for every inward look, 10 glances to Christ, 10 long gazes upon Christ. Do you see? So all this now gives you joy. Hebrews 12:2, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Believers, you are often told that you must walk the way of Calvary. That's true. But Calvary's not the end. It's not the end. The end goes up and up and up and up until you're seated at the right hand of him. Do you see that? And that should bring you joy. He's not getting glory for himself because he saved the most capable people on the planet. He's getting glory for himself because he saved the weakest and the smallest and those who were not and the base and those who never are. It's not that we just were not. I'm not now. My greatest moment of piety would only earn me death. If one fraction of this was based on us, there would be no hope, but it's not. It's the perfect work of Christ who accomplished. I love that word. The older I get, accomplished, accomplished, accomplished. He accomplished it. It's a done deal. You see? And therefore, having joy, Derek Kidder writes, joy is invigorating. Biblical joy is invigorating, not escapist. We can run headlong into the battle knowing we'll make it out. We can go into the darkest tunnel knowing this too will pass. I want to read from Charles Simeon just really quick. Charles Simeon, if you're a preacher, a pastor, expositor, buy all of it from Charles Simeon. All his preaching commentary on the Bible. It's one of the richest. I read Simeon almost as much as Spurgeon. It's a phenomenal expositor. He says, joy disposes for action. Fear and sorrow depress and overwhelm the soul. Can you identify with that? Yeah, but you don't know me. I have a reason to. Yeah, you do have a reason to. I agree with you. But you're not the reason. I have a reason to be sorrowful and depressed and cast down when I look at myself, but I'm not supposed to be looking at myself. What am I supposed to be looking at? Who am I supposed to be looking at? God, Christ, the accomplished work. Joy disposes for action. Fear and sorrow depress and overwhelm the soul. They enervate and benumb all our faculties. They keep us from attending to any encouraging considerations. They disable us from extending relief to others. They indispose us for the most necessary duties. We cannot pray or speak or do anything with pleasure. On the contrary, a joyous frame exhilarates the soul. David well knew the effect it would produce, and everyone may safely adopt his resolution. I will run the way of thy commandments when thou shalt enlarge my heart. You know what's amazing? I can be walking through the office and just hear what I think they keep a lot from me. Hear the brothers talking about someone else has made a film against Paul or someone is attacking Paul. And I think, I mean, in that second, I stop thinking about missions. I feel horrible about to go in my office to pray. The day, the writing, everything I was going to do, it's like. And then they come out and say, hey, Paul, what's up? Well, what were you talking about? Oh, you remember that thing that happened like 20 years ago? Oh, something new didn't happen? No. Oh, great. Let's talk about missions. Do you see that? You identify with that, don't you? Yeah, the news could have changed, but my God didn't change. Why am I so weak? You see? And how often do we sit there and lament and are afraid of something that doesn't even exist, like an 8-foot tarantula? He goes on to write, joy qualifies for suffering. When the spirit is oppressed, the smallest trial is a burden. In those seasons, we are apt to fret and murmur both against God and man. We consider our trials as the effects. Now listen, we consider our trials as the effects of divine wrath. Or overlooking God, we vent our indignation against the instruments he uses. But when the soul is joyous, afflictions appear light. How little did Paul and Silas regard their imprisonment? How willing was Paul to lay down his very life for Christ? This accords with the experience of every true Christian. And brothers, let me say this. If there is one area where very serious people about the Lord, sometimes we fail. I know I fail. I fail in this with my children. I fail in this with my wife. I fail in this with my brethren. And that is encouragement. Encourage. How many times does that word appear? Encourage, encourage, encourage. Instill courage. Instill hope. Instill. How many times, you know, your child could be out mowing the yard. And you realize, oh my gosh, he's 17. He's out there mowing the yard. Well, what's the big deal about that? Well, he's obediently mowing the yard. He's rather tall. He pushes that stronger than his dad can. And walk out in the yard and say, son, stop for a moment. I'm about to cry. You're amazing. You're just, thank you. Walk in, tell your wife, it's a good meal. Oh, that's nice. But what if you just sat down? I said, honey, sit down for a second. I just want you to know that this doesn't go unnoticed. You know, you prepare things from scratch. You do this, you cook. It just doesn't go unnoticed. I just want to encourage you in that. Encouragement, 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 encouragement. And you sit there, and you're like me, guys. You would do this if you would remember it. Right? Please say right, right. I would do this. Say right. Your wife is looking at you, okay? You want to say right now. Or maybe you should just, I don't know, paint it on your wall at work or something. But this is with the whole Christian life. We need encouragement. And what encouragement can do? I heard a testimony last night, dear sister from India. It's 11 o'clock. I'm really tired, and we're standing there for 40 minutes. It's the most encouraging thing I think I have heard in so long. Everything she shared with me about what God had done in her life just made me sit there and go, oh, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. God did that with her. Yeah, he's alive. Yeah, he's alive. Yeah, you can't write that one off. That's amazing. Do you see that? And that's one of the things I told Mac that I love about this conference. Even though I want to preach like 14 hours a day, and I'm probably on hour 14 this morning, I said, Mac, I think one of the most amazing things about this conference is the time that you men have wisely allowed for people just to be with one another. Because it's just beautiful. I mean, I've just talk with so many people, hear so many stories. Okay, let's get to obedience real quick. Obedience is founded upon faith. I want you to see that. A lot of times the word is used interchangeably in a way. You say, what do I mean? Don't look at obey, I want to do it, or disobey because I don't want to do it. Look at something else here. And this is what I tell my children this a lot. Okay. Who loves you more than you love you? God. Who's wiser than you? God. So why do we obey his commands? Because God loves us more than we love ourselves and is wiser than we are. He wants more for us than we want for ourselves. He wants better for us than we want for ourselves. And he has shown us the way to do it when we don't know how. That's obedience. Obedience is born out of faith. That this God, so young person, you've got this decision. There is this, you feel alone. You feel lonely. Maybe you're an older person, young person, and you desire a mate. And someone comes into your life, very handsome or very pretty, not a Christian, or not spiritual, not mature. And now you've got to make a decision. You really want to be in a relationship. You really want to. There's nothing wrong with that. That's wonderful. But now you've got to say, God tells me to do something else. God isn't saying you can't be with this person. What he's saying is you can't be with them now. And maybe it will be you can't be with them ever. And you've got to sit there and go, okay, God's telling me no. Does God love me? Or is he just trying? Does God love me or not? Yes, he loves me more than I could ever. Does he love me more than I love me? And boy, that would be difficult. Yeah, he loves you more than you love you. And he loves you in the right way, where you and I don't love ourselves in the right way. So he loves me. Okay, is he smarter than me? Yeah, he's smarter than me. Does he know what's best for me when sometimes I don't know what's best for me? My wife says, look, you don't know what's best for you. I know what's best for you. She does. Most of the time she knows what's best for me, especially with regard to eating broccoli. She knows.